Coming up next on SportsLink, Briggs Orsbon tells us what it's like to step up when his teammates need it. Ball State swimmer Kosh Jasmon shows us what true determination is. And strength coach Jason Roberson takes us inside the weight room. So hang on tight. You're watching SportsLink.
Good evening, Cardinal fans, and welcome to another edition of Ball State Sports Link. I'm Peter Carr, alongside Stephen Albritton.
We have tons in store for you in the next 30 minutes, including an inside look at men's volleyball and how they train in the offseason, and how also the field hockey team recruits. But first, the big news on Ball State's campus, the football team, cracking the top 25 rankings for the first time in school history.
It's new territory for the Cardinals after their win over MAC foe Toledo last Saturday. The Cards continue their remarkable season, rolling to a convincing 31-0 victory. It was Ball State's first shutout since the 2000 season. After a sluggish start, the Cardinals blew out the Rockets in the second half, scoring 28 unanswered points. MiQuale Lewis led the offense with two touchdowns, and his 157 yards rushing matched the entire offensive output for Toledo. Ball State's swarming defense was especially strong against the run, allowing only 14 yards rushing. Afterwards, head coach Brady Hoke was humbled by the national ranking.
It's flattering to be in the top 25, but who votes in the top 25? I don't know who the 25 best teams in this country are. I have no clue. And I think I may know a little more football than some other people involved. It's great. It's great for Ball State. It's great for the university. But we got a lot of work ahead of us. And, we've got a lot of things to do better before we even think of anything of that nature.
The last time the Cardinals started the season 6-0, their most famous alum, David Letterman, was still in high school, the year 1965. The top 25 ranking is the first in the football program's 84-year history. And with its sixth win, BSU becomes bowl eligible for the second year in a row.
It's great for the Cards, but like Coach Hoke said, there's a long season left, and staying ranked starts tomorrow night at Western Kentucky.
One playmaker for Ball State is MiQuale Lewis. He leads the Cards' rushing attack and already has 12 touchdowns. Later on, we'll find out how the running back was able to come back after suffering a season-ending knee injury a year ago.
And later on in the show, we'll take an in-depth look at how a freshman is expected to fill part of the void after the injury to Dante Love.
He currently leads the team with more than 50-yard receiving per game.
And Ball State University, to some, it's one stop for one family member. But for the Richards family, Ball State and the athletics department is a family affair.
My dad has been the tennis coach here for 36 years.
My husband's Rob Richards, who's the director of ticket operations.
My wife, Wendy, is a cheerleading coach and also a Ball State grad.
My niece cheers as well, Lexi Rodebeck.
Wendy and Rob are my aunt and uncle. And Bill is my Uncle Rob's dad.
Even though the family is large, the tradition all started with the success of head men's tennis coach Bill Richards.
I mean, I didn't develop this program overnight. I mean, we got in the conference in 74, and it was 10 years before we won our first conference championship.
As a tennis coach, he's had a lot of success, and I've been a big part of the program from a kid growing up, just going to all the matches.
10 years ago, Wendy and Rob were married and continued the family being at Ball State.
I met Rob through cheerleading because he was the cheerleading advisor because he was the athletic administrative assistant in the athletic department.
I got to know her through athletics also, so in a way you can say that Ball State athletics and Ball State kind of brought us together.
Lexi Rodebeck decided to follow her family's path into Ball State and continue the athletic tradition by becoming a cheerleader.
I wanted to come to Ball State, and then all my family came, so it made me want to come more.
I do more for her because she's younger, but it's nice to be able to see them. It's nice to be able to look after them.
Now, although the Richards family is all throughout Ball State athletics, they feel they owe much more to the university than what the university has given to them.
It's been a real big part of my life and my family's life. We're very loyal to the school. It's given me my education, undergrad and graduate degree.
Ball State has been my professional life, and It's that there are advantages and disadvantages to staying in one place your whole career.
Kind of changed my life to, I could have taken a, there's a branch in the road. I could have went one way or the other. Once I started cheering, my life changed because of Ball State.
And the next generation of Ball State is already scheduled to graduate in 2022.
We'll leave that up to him, but as of now, I would say the chances are pretty good.
Wherever he wants to go, but yeah, he'll probably end up here too.
Stephen Albritton, SportsLink.
By this point, field hockey goalie Tiffany Shifflett is a seasoned vet. But what it's like being the last line of defense? Brendan Clemens has the story.
Ball State field hockey goalie Tiffany Shifflett is in her second year as full-time starter, but says much of her learning happened from the sideline.
I think being able my freshman year to sit and listen to how the game is being played, and then once I came in my sophomore year working on it, I have a really good idea of how the defense should be set up on the field.
There are many different fundamentals that go into being a good goalkeeper, but according to Shifflett, one stands out.
You have to be a talker. You have to be able to let people know where they need to go, not be shy about it. You got to step in and kind of take charge. So if you're quiet, there's no way you can be a goalkeeper.
Shifflett's performance has impressed a lot of people, including her teammates.
Oh my gosh, I mean, she's just like a wall back there. I mean, when she, oh, I love it when she comes through and does like a little slide and gets the ball out of there. I mean, when it gets past me, I'm not that scared, to be honest, because she's just a brick wall.
Goalkeepers get a lot of credit for keeping this ball out of that goal, but Shifflett is the first to admit that her teammates give her quite a bit of help.
With me, I like to set my defenders up to take shots on the outsides wide. So if they can give me the shots and force a player outside, that helps me tremendously.
Now with over 200 career saves, Shifflett has made her mark. Brandon Clemens, Ball State SportsLink.
Shifflett now has 219 saves on her career and 67 saves through 11 games this season. She also has started 29 consecutive games for the field hockey team. And coming up later in the show, the inspirational story of one Ball State swimmer who's not letting a disease stop her from doing what she loves.
Ball State fans still have their thoughts and prayers with Dante Love, but they have turned their attention back to the football field. Luckily for them, there is one player ready to take that role.
When Ball State fans found out star receiver Dante Love was done playing football, the first question they asked was who would step up.
It's a post at 38.
Second and four, first down. Briggs Orsbon, the freshman, heading to the end zone, touchdown!
Davis turns around, fakes the handoff to MiQuale Lewis, rolling to his left, throws to the end zone, touchdown! Ball State, Briggs Orsbon, calls it in for the score.
You know, some of the guys came up to me and said, you know, it's your time to step up. I mean, I have to step up a little bit more and improve every week and get better.
Although Orsbon is just a freshman, his production has more than doubled in the last three games since Dante Love's injury.
Oh, yes, definitely. He stepped up a lot. Definitely. He's not playing like a freshman. You know, he makes some freshman mistakes, but that, I mean, that's along the way. But, you know, he's got to keep on working hard.
You know, they just said that I'd have to, grow up, mature, and, go out there and do the best I can, play confident and play with a little swagger like Dante.
Well, he's very mature and very confident. He has a quiet confidence. He's not a showboat or a bragger, but he knows he can play, and he's very smart. He listens, he learns, critical of himself, which I think is a great quality. I mean, we got on the bus coming back from Toledo, and all he talked about was a couple balls he dropped.
This isn't the first time that Briggs Orsbon has been asked to step up. When he was in high school, his teammate and quarterback was hurt, and the coaches asked him to finish out the season playing quarterback.
I knew he could run, catch, and throw, and I really got sold on Briggs when I saw him play center field in baseball because he had good eye-hand coordination, good skills. He's just an all-around athlete, and he has real, real, real good hands. And he came here because he possessed those qualities and he wanted to do what Dante gets to do.
Orsbon said he feels he has the trust of his teammates and coaches.
I know the upperclassmen and everyone else really, you know, they've told me that they believe in me and that they think I can do it.
Still, Orsbon knows he can't replace Dante Love.
It kind of came to a point where the entire team has to step up because I'm not Dante. I can't do everything that he's done for this program, where the whole team has to compensate for his offense and his abilities.
Briggs Orsbon will no doubt continue to be a vital part of the Ball State offense. Cameron Andre, Ball State Sports Link.
And taking a look at Briggs Orsbon's productions before and after Love's injury, you can clearly see how much he's done for the team. Only 7 catches before, 18 after, and he's nearly doubled, or excuse me, over doubled his production beforehand. Hasn't gotten in the end zone left, but hey, he's doing it big for the Cardinals.
The weight room is a common place for every athlete, regardless of the sport. They go there to get stronger, faster, and show off their muscles. But as SportsLink's Josh Clark found out, muscles might not be the most important thing for the men's volleyball team.
Weight room training is a typical activity for any sports team, and volleyball is no different. But why is weight room training so important? Strength coach Jason Roberson lets us know that exact answer.
Injury prevention, if I can say it in just a very short sentence, what we do is not necessarily geared towards promoting absolute strength or promoting absolute any of one thing, but what more I'm looking for is the development of athletic movements. And if I can develop their ability to move, I can reduce the number of injuries they have.
Most important thing, so we want our guys to stay injury free. We need to be able to go through a long season, January to May, and be able to practice on a daily basis and compete on the weekends with our team without losing guys because their bodies break down.
But if weight room training is so important, how do you make sure that your time is going to be well spent?
Keep moving. We don't let them sit around very much. We always have a specific workout designed for them. Everything is done specifically for a purpose. Each day I come in and I know exactly what we're working on, what skills we're trying to develop, what movement patterns we're trying to develop, and so we work towards those goals. There's no free-for-all. You can do what you want. Come in, here's the weight room time. It's definitely specific hours for a specific purpose.
When most people think of the weight room, they think of something like this. But that's not necessarily the case with this team.
With the sport of volleyball, it's all body weight. The ball weighs several ounces. It's not a heavy item. There's very little collision. You very seldomly, if ever, take on any external load. It's all internal. It's all body weight. And so we do a lot of body weight type stuff. However, with volleyball, they do great ranges of motion. And so that's the reason why you see a lot of the stretching and a lot of the deep range of motion, like you heard me today talking about squatting.
Even though weight training doesn't give you wins and losses, coach still has a goal for the season.
No strained hamstrings, no strained quads, no strained abdominals, no rotator cuff injuries. If any of those things could happen, that's a perfect season for me. And that's so far the unattainable. That's what I'm looking for, but that's so far the unattainable.
Josh Clark, Ball State Sports Link.
Hopefully the offseason training will pay off for the volleyball team. Last season, Ball State finished the regular season with an 18-12 record and looks to continue their winning ways against Stanford in the season opener on January 17th at Worthen Arena.
And once again, it's time to put another sport under the spotlight. Last time it was women's volleyball, and we found out Coach Dave Booz loves folding laundry. Men's golf is next under the spotlight.
Out of all of you, who has the goofiest swing?
Out of anybody on the team, I would definitely say Ross Kosat.
Between Ross Kosat and Coach Flatt.
He takes it back, and then when he comes through, he kind of cocks his head like this, and I don't know, it's really messed up, but he hits it pretty good.
Ross Kosat, we're always giving him stuff, but Coach Fleck holds the golf club like a baseball bat. And anybody that knows anything about golf and how you grip the club, that's not even close, but he makes it work.
All right, your head coach, Mike Fleck. Can you beat him?
Oh, yeah. No doubt.
Yeah, definitely.
We played Saturday up in Fort Wayne, and I got in him a little bit Saturday, but he's definitely had his moments where he's beaten me, too.
He beat me in the game, but I beat him overall.
So you're telling me both you and Andrew beat your own head coach?
Oh, yeah. We went up to we call it a big boys golf course. He's good around these courses in Muncie, but we got to to the real deal, and Rosie and I stepped up to the plate.
Okay, away from golf, what talents do you have?
I like to play pool and ping pong.
I was a drummer in a marching band in high school, and it's still something to this day that I love to do.
Me, Novak, and Steger, we get some heated battles going on the ping pong table.
Played in the percussion for about 8 or 9 years, you know, before college, and that music's definitely a passion of mine.
If you could be president for one day, what would you do?
I'd just take a personal day.
You know, probably fly about everywhere I could in one day, so get on Air Force One.
I'd probably go overseas. Something I've never done, something I always wanted to do. You know, I'd definitely use Air Force One, get over there, have some fun.
If you could be a plant, what kind of plant would you be?
A plant?
Oh, man.
Jeez. Probably being a spy trap. I don't know, just someone makes you mad, you just snap at them. Pretty easy.
I'd be a rose so I can give it to some girl.
I'm Brian Maurer, and Ball State Sports Link, just put me under the spotlight.
I'm Andrew Rhodes, and Ball State Sports Link, just put me under the spotlight.
Andrew Rhodes would be a rose so he could give it to a girl. Ladies, keep him in mind. It's always good stuff when we put athletes under the spotlight.
Giants of the offensive line that has only let up 4 sacks this season.
And looking ahead to the future, Ball State Sports Link, our next studio show, is going to be October 24th, 2008, 6 p.m. right here on WIPB, Cardinal Division 57, and ballstatesports.com. Stats, records, and rankings are often what we center our sports coverage around, but sometimes a single person's story goes deeper than that. Sometimes a single person's is more than anything you can record on a stat sheet. SportsLink's Josh Clark has the story.
My name is Kosh Jasmon, and I'm 20 years old and a member of the Ball State women's swimming and diving team. I have myasthenia gravis. It's a neuromuscular autoimmune disease. When they first told me that I wasn't going to be able to swim for a while, I didn't accept it. I said, no, I'm going to continue as long as I can. You know, they've told me that my dreams are impossible. I'm not going to be able to do this, but you know, up to this point, I've proven them wrong. I'm a firm believer that nothing is impossible. It just means that nobody's accomplished that yet. And I thought, you know, I'll be the first one if I have to be, but I'm gonna do it.
I always call her Katie, and she can't stand that. I guess that's just my nature, is to get under the skin a little bit. Katie, what a sweet kid. How can anyone whine and complain with little aches and pains when they see her at the end of practice be pulled out of the pool, packed in ice, and then she has to be assisted down the length of the pool just to get to the locker room.
Instead of complaining about the things that she can't do, she cherishes and worships the things that she can do. For all the right reasons. She doesn't get upset about the fact that this has disabled her. Instead, she's excited about the things that she's able to do. And that to me is the mark of a true champion. That to me is a mark of a true person that's going someplace in life.
Despite everything that she's been hit with this condition, with this disease, she still has so many goals, so many dreams. She has so much to live for. And that's why she's truly an inspiration.
Myasthenia gravis is one of the least common autoimmune disorders, only affecting between 200 and 400 people out of a million.
Ball State football breaks the national top 25 for the first time in school history through sheer determination and the belief that any obstacle can be overcome. No one exemplifies the never give up and never surrender spirit more than star running back MiQuale Lewis.
After suffering 3 season-ending injuries in 4 years, many players would walk away from the game. But Ball State running back MiQuale Lewis took them in stride.
He worked so he could get back. His work ethic's extraordinary. Once he puts his mind to something, he'll definitely achieve it.
Lewis has worked hard to come back from injury in his 2 seasons in college. And says the hardest part about rehab is not physical.
You gotta be mentally strong. You can't never let a day go by. You're like, man, this is pointless. What am I doing this for? You? There's always got to be a reason why you're doing this. So I just try to keep a positive attitude about everything.
Strength and conditioning coach Aaron Wellman pushed Lewis throughout his rehab so that he would come back stronger than when he got hurt.
He's always in my head. I got to compete if I want to be the best. Do extra reps, do everything extra.
Lewis's extra work paid off, and he returned to the starting lineup for the first game of the season. Quarterback Nate Davis knows what Lewis brings to the field.
He's a very hard worker, you know, and he goes hard at everything he does. You know, he's 110% every play he goes.
Head coach Brady Hoke says the running back is a key part of the offense.
Being able to run the football, you know, and it starts with the guys up front, but, you know, you've got a talented guy like Quayle. When you look at vision and balance and some of those things he adds, I mean, it's awfully important.
Averaging more than 130 yards per game, but gives all the credit to the big guys who block for him up front.
Our offense wouldn't be anything without Bill. You know, they establish a line of scrimmage. You know, I think they're the best in the nation. No, I don't think I know that they're the best in the nation.
After each touchdown, Lewis shows his appreciation for the O-line.
You know, I always hug and say I love him every time.
Lewis's teammates know the bond goes both ways.
That's why a lot of the guys out here have just tremendous respect for him, because he's a guy that's going to do whatever it takes to win.
Lewis's strong desire to win aligns with the team goals.
Our goal is to win the MAC. You know, it's not how you start, it's how you finish. And we're on a mission to win the MAC.
MiQuale Lewis will continue to carry the load for the Ball State Cardinals for the rest of the season.
In the win over Toledo last week, MiQuale Lewis carried the ball 31 times. But according to Coach Hoke, that number should decrease with the use of freshman Corey Sykes, who ran for a touchdown and 90 yards against the Rockets.
The field hockey team has players only from other states and one from another country. But the question still remains, how do we get players to come play at Ball State? SportsLink's Brandon Clemens found out.
High school field hockey in Indiana. Head coach Annette Payne has to recruit out of state, which might not be as difficult as you think.
To be honest with you, it's not hard. It's just something that we're used to. It's not hard by any means. I mean, we've got talent from all over.
And I'm from St. Louis.
I'm Louisville, Kentucky.
I'm Brooke McGillivray. I'm a junior, and I'm from North Vancouver, British Columbia, Canada.
We just make sure that we get to the right recruiting events, and it's not difficult.
So how did these players end up at Ball State?
The tournament. It's called Festival, and teams from all across the states go, and a couple teams from Canada go. They sent a team down my year, and that's where I met the coaches.
I actually found out about Ball State when I was in the seventh grade. My team came here for a field hockey camp, so that's how I was informed about them.
It was just a big thing for me to get into a college for field hockey, and when I was looking at different schools from East Coast to Midwest, picking where I wanted to go was just really hard for me to, like, choose. But when I came here, I committed that day because I loved it so much.
You just talk to them a lot. You just make sure that you do your homework on them. You make sure that they're the type of athlete that's going to fit in well here. You make sure that they're going to fit into your program. You make sure that the student athletes that you already have here, they're going to get along with them and they're going to be able to compliment them. You make sure that what you ask of them is only fair, that they'll fit in here, that they'll do well here as a student athlete.
Brandon Clemens, Ball State SportsLink.
The field hockey team looks to end their 9-game losing streak tomorrow when they host Central Michigan. Game time is 1 p.m. at the BSU Turf Field.
Abby Melillo finds the back of the net here for Ball State in Sunday's 3-0 victory over Kent State. It was one of 7 goals for the Cardinals last weekend. The Cardinals won both games and held a ring ceremony to celebrate the MAC championship from last season. After the game, Captain Annie Aiello talked about the team's goals.
Tournament this year. We had a slow start, but I think we're starting to peak now, and that's really going well for us.
And sticking with soccer and looking ahead, SportsLink next live remote will be a soccer game October 30th, 3 p.m., Cardinal Vision 57.
MiQuale Lewis and Nate Davis may be making all the headlines, but the reason for the team's success is the O-line that is clearing the way. SportsLink's James Ryder caught up with one of those linemen, senior right tackle Robert Brewster.
Right tackle Robert Brewster claims that Dan Gerber is the biggest practical joker on the offensive line. But don't let Brewster fool you. He has jokes and competitions with the other O-linemen.
At the end of the game, we always ask how many pancakes you have, and it's like, oh, I have more than you. I got you, Adore. Or I know me and Drake, when we watch a film, it's always, I'll sit back and look at him like, you see which way he cut back, don't you? He cut back to the right, and you know, I mean, he does the same thing to me, so it's just all love out there.
All joking aside, Brewster is very serious when it comes to protecting quarterback Nate Davis.
After my experience with Buffalo, when I had my first sack, after I see him get hit like that, I said, never again. I'll never joke with that. I mean, I treat the quarterback, I treat Nate like he's my mom, man.
One thing that unites the offensive linemen are their beards.
The beard thing, it started in the summertime. I started growing mine out, and I told Gerberry, I was like, why don't we all grow them out and just keep them growing until the end of the season?
Brewster told me they won't cut their beards until after their bowl game. James Ryder, Ball State Sports Link.
With the big guys leading the way up front, Ball State looks to make their record 7-0 this week or tomorrow night against Western Kentucky. Steve, any predictions for the game this weekend?
I don't really make predictions. I'm going to put this one on you, dude. I'm going to put this one on you.
You know what? I'm going to say it's 48-20.
That sounds like a good prediction. I mean, Ball State's playing really, really well.
Well, that was another great edition of Sports Link. And for Stephen Albritton, I'm Peter Carr. Same time in 2 weeks from now, same time, same place. For all your Ball State sports news.